You should be on, brother.
We're on? Are we on?
We look like we are.
Is this thing on?
Hey, welcome to Class in Session on B-Real TV and Pot TV. Are we on Pot TV today?
No, not yet.
No, on B-Real TV and
we will
on
be later.
Pot TV later in the archives. See, there's a way we can do both, but we need two functional computers. And sometimes that's easier said than done at this time of day when people are using their computers. So it's been another week. Hopefully you guys had a good one. I had an awesome one. It was so nice here. Spent a lot of time in Stanley Park, sleeping on the beach. Got some nice rays. It's a good time. Ripping some Diana Ross. We've got a new command post here in the studios. Should we show the command post, Jer?
Oh, we should.
We got a second camera.
That's not hooked up yet, though.
What do you mean?
I'll hook it up.
We got a second camera that's not hooked up.
I need another camera extender. I'm using it as my door lock.
Oh, a door lock. Well, we could just turn this camera.
We got ignition. We got this thing. We can show this thing off. What are you smoking on, Al?
Diana Ross.
Oh yeah, the D.
Yeah, little bit of DR.
That's very nice. And explain that. What is the DR? What is the Diana Ross?
Diana Ross is a Northern Lights to Jammers. It's the two most commercial strains a person can get their hands on. And for some reason, it's not a high production plant, and it's fucking strong. like really strong. So, there's batches I've grown of it where it just puts me right to sleep. But I've noticed the longer I flower it, how's it going? The longer I flower it, the better it is. The less sleepy and the more up. You got your tripod? Woohoo! It's one thing about the BCMP Vapor Lounge. If you forget something here,
it's here when you come back.
As long as it's not good weed. Chances are the good weed will get smoked. But if it's a material object, like I said, we're not broadcasting on Pot TV.
We will have it up later, though.
No, I just got a text message saying there's nothing on Pot TV. Top of the morning. All right. So, while I was putting together the show today, I figured I'd put together a show on science that doesn't really exist anymore. Well, I guess it does exist, but the person who I basically kick-started this science, came out and said, you know what, you know all that stuff I've been talking? Nah, it doesn't exist. So, now there's two schools of thought on this subject, and that's black holes. Now, I figured we'd just play the popular stuff, rather than the stuff that discredits the black holes. We'll get to that maybe next week. Because there's a lot of info on that, too, on why they don't actually exist. So, yeah, I'll play some of that. I'm feeling like I got a feeling that I'm hooked on.
Yeah.
That's what I'm feeling.
Is that first on the list?
I think that's where we're going with that.
Okay.
I've got this feeling that I'm just hooked on. And I'm hoping this next video can help explain it a little bit. I can't quite put it into words, this feeling. And this video, I found it really, everything I'm feeling, this video sums up. It
let me
really
get,
does.
Let me get this video
it's
for
crazy.
You here.
It's very rare I find a video that can convey the stuff that I can't communicate properly.
oh, this is odd.
There's lots of odd things in the world, Jer.
There are a few
the
odd
platypus.
Things.
Platypus.
Platypus are very odd.
Yeah, platypus is extremely odd. The possum is quite odd.
They both look pretty odd.
Black holes are odd.
They are. If they exist.
If they even exist, which is odd in itself.
Which, you know, we're not so sure about.
I'm not sure anything exists, and I think given enough theory, you can prove or disprove anything.
So, looks like this
looks
thing
like
is pretty much ready to go anytime.
All right, because I'm really hooked.
You're hooked.
I got this feeling. I got so hooked on.
Oh, we got a little echo, but that's we all fixed up here.
We got the echo. I like the echo.
You like that echo? It's like a dub track.
It turns the show into something psychedelic.
It does, actually. Okay, so yeah.
Big ups!
We should be ready to roll anytime.
All right, let's rock this.
All right.
And can we crank it here in the studio?
Since you're so hooked. Yeah, well, I
feel
think
like
I can
dancing.
Do that. All right.
Cannabis juice in my bottle. Pot leaves and pineapples. Oh, yeah, here we go.
Back.
Man, I just can't dance today. We got no sound.
No sound coming out of the YouTube video.
No sound out of the old
YouTube.
Oh,
maybe this one got copyright jacked.
Really?
I don't know, but maybe it's because...
Is there another version of it?
Let me try and find one with sound.
We're going to try a different version. Take that.
Yeah, that's a little strange. Because the other ones have audio.
Because it's such a good video. Like, very influential. Extremely influential.
I know you're a big Hoff fan, Al.
I'm a big... Well, I wanted to get a disco band and call it Hasselhuffer.
Hasselhoff. It's the German way of hassling people?
Yeah. It's how you fuck somebody off and somebody off. Hasselhoff!
Oh, I just gave you a cool dub echo there for a second.
Nice.
So I was just doing some testing to make sure it wasn't the live stream that was screwing up, and it's not. It's the YouTube video.
It's the
YouTube video. So we're going to try and find one that has the sound here.
All right. You got the album version on there? No, we need the video, though.
You got to have the vid.
Yeah, man.
See, it's that somebody stole this. Hasselhoff probably had it taken the sound off or something. They can do that.
That's funny because I was watching it at like 4 o'clock this morning.
Well, I just typed in Hooked on a Feeling. There could be several copies.
Hmm.
This one is definitely not the original uploaded by the Hoff himself.
Haralder is the one I uploaded. I checked it off.
Let's check it out.
Haralder.
Hasselhoff.
Hasselhuffer.
Hooked
whatever
on a feeling.
Whatever happened to those famous photos of his? You know, where he was like all junked out.
Oh no, he was drunk or something, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was all puked up in a robe.
Now I got sound.
We got sound! We're gonna ooga chaga all fucking morning. Cause I'm hooked on a feeling. I don't know about you guys. Ooga chaga, ooga, ooga.
I can't stop this feeling deep inside of me. Girl, you just don't realize what you do to me. When you hold me in your arms so tight, you let me know everything's all right. Hooked on a feeling, I'm high on believing.
He's looking at him. He's frozen now, singing.
Hooked on a freezing.
That's a shame. That's a shame. Well, we probably had too much of that anyway, Al.
He's like, fuck, dude. Come on, man.
No, you should be back now.
We're back. We got shut down.
Yeah.
Hasselhoff is like, fuck you, you fuckers. Hooked on this.
Frozelhoff.
Yeah, that's we're both hooked on a feeling.
That I don't know how that ever got made. Like, did he make it? He was serious when he was making that too. That's
dude,
the thing.
He's
like,
he's a very serious and accomplished songwriter.
Well, yeah, he didn't write that Berlin Wall. One. That's a cover, but
that guy played the Berlin Wall. You know that, eh?
No.
Yeah.
Yeah. What did he played soccer on it or something?
No, he played a fucking set on the Berlin Wall. That's how influential Hasselhoff is.
The Hoff. He has a lot of fans.
He's got a lot of fans.
They love him in Germany.
Not all of them are electric.
So,
I think he comes from a lot of money.
You think so? Well, he's really rich because of Baywatch.
No, I think he was rich way before. I think his dad's a very rich guy.
Oh, that could be.
Yeah.
Why do you think that?
It's just a theory I have.
No real reason. That should be on the rumor
mill. When bad actors turn into bad musicians and become international icons, there's only one thing behind
it. But everybody's making fun of him, though.
No way, man. In Europe, they treat him serious. Like, he's like fucking, he's like Justin Bieber over there.
Can't treat that guy seriously either.
He's like the Biebs. Oh, I treat Biebs very seriously. That guy rocks.
Did you hear his latest song?
I got money, what do you got?
No, he's been saying he did a bunch of racist stuff.
Racist stuff?
Oh man, you haven't heard of this
now?
I hate
white people?
No, a bunch of videos of him as a kid came out where he is making a really bad racist joke against black people.
He's a kid.
Yeah,
though.
I know.
What,
and then
he eight?
No, he was like 14. But then there's a one of him singing one of his songs, Another Lonely Girl or Just Another Lonely Girl or something like that. But he replaces the lyrics with the N-word and says that if he joins the KKK, there'll be one less lonely N-word. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, it's and he's on video singing that to the camera and laughing. It's really bad. But everybody in the
how many brothers were in the room with him?
Good question.
Because he hangs out with a lot of bros.
Well, and that's the
you know what I mean. So
that's the thing is a bunch of and Lil Wayne and a bunch of those
you know
guys have
I mean?
Come out
like,
and said
I'm sure
he was a kid doing his thing.
I think it's shit that's taken out of context and blown out of proportion.
Well, no, this could not be taken out of context.
Well, you don't know in what scenario. He could have been sitting around with a whole bunch of brothers.
Well, that's true.
And they were all joking about him, be like, yeah, man, you should join the KKK, you little fucker.
Yeah,
You know what I mean?
Oh, no, totally.
And then he's singing, making. We don't know any of that.
That is true.
And in which case, that would make it, would that not make it acceptable?
Talk to your microphone.
Would that not make it acceptable?
Yes, it would.
Maybe not, but.
Well, actually, I don't think it would make it acceptable,
no,
but at least it would explain it a little.
I don't know.
Talk into that mic some more.
What do you mean?
Okay, there we go. We got you. We keep losing you because you're not pointing in that direction.
All right.
There you
go. I don't like things pointed at me.
Microphones are a different story.
Especially things shaped like this. Can we get like little wireless lapel mics?
We have a couple of those, but they're not very accurate, and you do get fuzz on them anytime you touch them.
Actually,
so.
That's true. On a lapel mic, my voice sounds it's way different.
Shut up.
It's way different.
They're not accurate in the wireless signal.
No, it's
but
it's,
unless you pay a lot of money for them, and there's a gap between the cheap ones and the expensive
ones. I fucking talk like this when I got a fucking those fucking propel mics on the fucking those fucking little propel mics. I fucking talk just like that, man. But on these mics, I talk normal. Oh, my jars? Oh, that's because I don't have the high stack of jars.
That's right. You do have.
You know,
some
there's
nice
a
jars
there's
there,
good
though.
Things and bad things about these little jars.
The good thing is I can fit way more flavors in my backpack. I dig that a lot. And the bad things? I don't know. I forgot them when I realized I could fit more, way more flavors in my backpack.
All right. So,
I don't know. What should we play?
You got a lot of videos here.
We do got a lot of videos. Let's play, let's go inside a black hole.
That sounds fun.
We're going straight traveling inside a black hole. This is it. Life's over. So traveling into the fictitious.
What's the fascination with black holes this week, Al?
You know, I really don't know. I started going through YouTube and I found these... I don't know how I got to black holes from fucking David Hasselhoff, because that was the... I went onto YouTube and I typed in the David Hasselhoff theory. And a whole bunch of fucking David Hasselhoff videos came up, and way like 30 videos in, there was a black hole video.
Yeah.
So I went from there and I just kept going.
I think there's a
relationship. So I don't know, maybe David Hasselhoff comes from a black hole. I'm really not sure. But I figured, you know, that was, it's a logical link. David Hasselhoff, black holes. Yeah. I was going to play a 45-minute lecture from Neville Goddard on the laws of manifesting choice.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this is ready anytime you are, my friend.
I was born ready.
Born ready.
I was so born ready, I had hair right from my eyebrows back, all the way down my back.
All right, I'm playing.
That's how ready I was.
Hey, Vsauce, Michael here.
And it'd be cold out there.
We are going to go inside
a black hole.
It's not going to be comfortable, but it will be pretty fun. Now, first things first, mathematically speaking, anything could become a black hole. If you were to compress it into a small enough space, that's right, you, me, this camera, everything in the universe has what is known as a Schwarzschild radius, a tiny, tiny amount of space that, were you to collapse the entire mass of the object into, its density would be so great that its gravitational pull would be so great that not even light could escape from it. You would have a black hole. If you were to compress Mount Everest into something smaller than a nanometer, you would have a black hole. And if you were to compress the entire Earth down to the size of a peanut, you would have a black hole. But fortunately for us, there is no known way to compress Everest or Earth in that fashion. But a star, many, many, many times larger than our own sun, has a much larger Schwarzschild radius. And when it runs out of fuel and can no longer keep itself hot enough, it collapses to a single infinitesimally small point known as a singularity. Its density will be infinite, and so its gravitational pull will be so strong that nothing can escape, not even light. But enough about ways black holes form, let's jump into one. First question, what would it look like from the outside? Well, we know that gravitational fields bend space and time. Stars behind our sun will actually appear to be in slightly different locations from Earth because the sun's gravitational field bends the light coming from those stars. When it comes to the gravitational fields of larger objects, like entire galaxies, or for that matter, a black hole, the effect is even nuttier. Light coming from objects behind them is significantly distorted, producing smears and smudges. As seen from Earth, the blue galaxy behind this red galaxy is completely distorted, like a funhouse mirror. So rather than appearing as it really should, it looks to us like a ring, a smudge all the way around the red galaxy. This is known as gravitational lensing. Now take a look at this simulation of a black hole with a galaxy millions of light years behind it. The galaxy is not really in danger of the black hole's suck, but the light coming off of that galaxy certainly is. Watch as the galaxy passes behind the black hole, and its light is contorted, twisted, and distorted. Now here's a really fun demonstration. What if the Earth were to orbit around a black hole. Looking from the outside, the Earth would look normal at first, but as soon as it passed behind the black hole's gravitational field would warp the light reflecting off the Earth, producing this. For the sake of simplicity, let's jump into a simple black hole, one that doesn't have a charge and isn't moving, and also isn't already sucking up a bunch of matter, so it's just there on its own. As we approach, the distortion of the sky grows greater and greater. A larger and larger portion of our field of view looking forward into the black hole will be filled with darkness. At this point, where half of our field of view has been swallowed up in darkness, we have reached the photon sphere. At this point, light is not going to necessarily get sucked into the black hole, but it doesn't necessarily leave it either. Instead, at this magical point in space, light, photons, can actually orbit the black hole. If you were to stop here for a moment and look to the side, you could theoretically see the back of your own head, because light reflecting off the back of your head would travel all the way around the sphere of the black hole right back to your face. A gravitational field not only warps space, it also warps time. Now, for most intents and purposes here on Earth, we never have to worry about that. But near a black hole, gravity would be so strong that an observer standing, watching you jump into the hole, would see something quite strange. They wouldn't see you get sucked quickly into the hole. Instead, they would see your approach become slower and slower and slower until you reached a point known as the event horizon. This is a point in space where, once crossed, there's no going back. It is at that point that light can no longer escape. And so to a person watching you fall into the hole, that would be where your journey ended. You would seem almost frozen in space, the light coming off your body becoming increasingly redshifted until you simply faded into nothingness. They would never see you cross the event horizon. But for you, of course, everything would seem fine and dandy. You would continue past that horizon to your now inevitable death. As you continue to approach the black hole's singularity, your view of the entire universe would get compressed into a smaller and smaller point in space behind you. If the black hole we're jumping into is large enough, things might actually be quite comfortable at that event horizon. We'll know that we're never going to escape and that our lives are pretty much over, but it might take us hours to actually reach a point where things started to hurt. Why would they hurt? Well, the closer you get to the singularity, the more significant the difference in gravitational pull is across space. And so parts of me that are closer to the singularity would be pulled more strongly than parts that were facing away, and my entire body would be stretched toward the singularity. The effect would be so incredible, scientists don't usually call it stretching, they call it spaghettification. Once you reached this point, you would be dead. Your molecules would be violently ripped and stretched apart, and when they got to the singularity, well, we don't really know what would happen. Perhaps they would completely disappear in violation of all the laws of physics, or maybe they would reappear elsewhere in the universe. It's believed that a moving or spinning black hole might actually create what is known as a wormhole, a way of transitioning across space faster than light. Not in any way that violates the laws of science, but in a way that takes advantage of the universe's dimensions. For instance, if I wanted to get from this point, I'd have to travel the distance. But theoretically, a wormhole would do something really crazy. For instance, this. Now, the two points are right next to each other and I can travel between them almost instantaneously. But again, this is all theoretical. Luckily, we do have a possible way of analyzing black holes right here on Earth. Enter the dumb hole. Just as a black hole does not permit light to escape, a dumb hole is an acoustic black hole. It won't allow sound to escape. It doesn't have to be nearly as powerful, and scientists have been able to create dumb holes in laboratories using special fluids traveling at the speed of sound. A lot of progress still needs to be made in the world of acoustic black holes, but we may be able to learn an amazing amount of information about how black holes work by looking at how sound is treated in a dumb hole. Now here's another good question. What would it look like to travel at the speed of light, say, toward the sun? Well, surprisingly, you wouldn't just see the sun immediately rush up toward you. No. In fact, initially, it would look almost as if the sun were receding away from you. Why? Because your field of view would vastly increase in size. You would be able to see stuff almost behind you. And here's why. As you sit there, not moving yet, looking at the sun, there's light coming from stuff behind you. But if you travel the speed of light, you will actually reach that light coming from things behind you. As you reached light speed, your field of view would expand like this, concentrating the stuff in the middle. But where are you in the universe? Or here's a better question, where is the center of the universe? Well, this might sound crazy, but it's everywhere. This is known as the cosmological principle. No matter where you are in the universe, everything else will seem to be moving away from you, expanding at the same rate. The universe is expanding, but not like a balloon getting bigger with all the people inside it. Instead, it's as if we are the surface of a balloon. If you were to put a bunch of dots on a balloon and then blow it up, all of the dots would move away from each other at the same rate. And on the surface of the balloon, there is no center. Take a look at these two layers. They are exactly similar, except the top layer represents a 5% expansion of the bottom layer. Let's say that you live on one of these dots, and you want to measure where everything's moving away from. Well, watch what happens when I line up a dot in the past and the present. Boom, it looks like the center of the expansion. I can do this with any dot. As soon as I choose a dot to be the frame of reference, it immediately becomes the center of the expansion. So while dying in a black hole would be lonely and scary and morbid, when you look up into the sky, think instead about this. No matter where you are or who you are or what your friends or your parents tell you, you really scientifically are the center of the universe. Finally, what if our universe was a Googleplex meters across? It is nowhere near that large, but if it was, it would be so voluminous that statistically, it would be nearly impossible for there not to be an exact copy of you somewhere else out there in the universe. To see why, I highly suggest that you click right there and check out Brady Heron's new channel, Number File. It's part of the YouTube original channels, and I've worked with these guys before. They're amazing. They're my favorite kind of geeks. So check out that video, watch their other stuff, and if you like math, I highly suggest that you subscribe. And as always, thanks for watching.
We're back?
Yep.
Hi. I think we're back. We are back.
You surely are.
Shirley.
Yes, we are, and don't call me Shirley.
The electrical room is the one with the 420 poster. Yeah, I've got no social media.
Zero.
Yeah. Zero Facebook, zero Instagram. I've got a dead Twitter. There's been like 3 tweets out of it since November 2013. Thanks to Juan, he set it up for me when I was in Holland, but I just don't. Here, 2 dumb phones still don't make a smartphone. Yeah, I've just never really got into the whole social media thing, but it's the way things are done, really. It's a different world we're in. It's a total different world we're in. From 10 years ago to today, completely different.
Yeah, things are changing at a rapid...
A very rapid pace.
Oh, and speaking of changes...
It's all because of the black holes. And that feeling that Hasselhoff is hooked on.
I'm going to cut over this cam, Al.
Oh, yeah, yeah, check this out. This is the future.
Got our little station in the corner now.
We got a Pot TV studio.
We're kind of set up here. It's a little bit better for us.
Ooh, as the light falls.
It's literally
the red green Canadian.
I tried to tape a light here with duct tape, but it melts the tape. So I need a bigger piece of duct tape. I just can't find my roll of duct tape anymore. That was my temporary lighting system. Nice.
We
yeah,
do everything with duct tape
studio,
here in
though.
Canada.
Check this shit out. Nice. So we can
You're back.
We're back. Fucking A. All right.
Where's my duct tape?
I don't know. I sold it. I sold it for glue and I huffed it with Hasselhoff. He's known on the streets as Hasselhuffer. I heard it on the rumor mill. He sniffs glue. I also heard that that Katy Perry had two live alligators turned into shoes.
Live alligators?
Yeah, they're still live, so she doesn't have to walk. She just puts her feet in the alligators.
That's a pretty good idea.
They move around for her. I heard that on the rumor mill. So I don't know if it's true. Could be.
I like that one. Somebody's going to do that now.
The rumor mill allows you to say anything, you know. Like the Pope is Marilyn Monroe. Did you know that? Did you guys know that the Pope is Marilyn Monroe? I heard that on the rumor mill.
Must be true.
Though I don't know if it's true or not. They're all rumors. They mill them.
Well, turns out I don't have any more duct tape.
We got no more duct tape. So our special guest is canceled today because duct tape was our guest. Fucking tape.
Duct tape Pete.
This weed juice is just a good thing. All humanity should be drinking weed juice. It makes me feel good on my game, even though my shoulder's sore. It doesn't bother me. Well, it does, but I'm pretty happy about it. Should we get the long one out of the way? We got Spock. Spock is going to talk to us about black holes, but it's like 25 minutes. So roll like 6 joints and see how fast you can smoke them. That's what I say. Yep. Coincidentally, it's the longest video. Because the black holes are so big, they had to make this video a little longer.
That makes perfect sense.
Yeah. I mean, we could play half of it and then break for a tune. For a song, come back and sing you guys a song. Ooga chaka, ooga chaka. I'm hooked on a feeling, guys. Such a feeling, this feeling I'm hooked on. All right. Let's rock some Leonard Nimoy.
Let's do it. Here he is.
Spock. Spock's gonna get this whole show banned. I know it. I so know that this show is going to be bad.
Awesome, crazy dub echo there for a sec again. It's like, yeah, man, you know.
Chino, Bino, Fono, Bono, Brethren.
All right, here we go. Spocker.
We've never seen them directly. Yet we know they're there. Lurking within dense star clusters. Or wandering the dust lanes of the galaxy. Where they prey on stars. Or swallow planets whole. Our Milky Way may harbor millions of black holes, the ultra-dense remnants of dead stars. But now, in the universe far beyond our galaxy, there's evidence of something far more ominous. A breed of black holes that has reached incomprehensible size and destructive power. Just how large and violent and strange can they get? A new era in astronomy has revealed a universe long hidden to us. High-tech instruments sent into space have been tuned to sense high-energy forms of light, X-rays and gamma rays, that are invisible to our eyes and do not penetrate our atmosphere. On the ground, precision telescopes are equipped with technologies that allow them to cancel out the blurring effects of the atmosphere. They are peering into the far reaches of the universe and into distant cauldrons of light and energy. In some distant galaxies, astronomers are now finding evidence that space and time are being shattered by eruptions so vast they boggle the mind. We are just beginning to understand the impact these outbursts have had on the universe, on the shapes of galaxies, the spread of elements that make up stars and planets, and ultimately, the very existence of Earth. The discovery of what causes these eruptions has led to a new understanding of cosmic history. Back in 1995, the Hubble Space Telescope was enlisted to begin filling in the details of that history. Astronomers selected tiny regions in the sky between the stars. For days at a time, they focused Hubble's gaze on remote regions of the universe. These Hubble deep field images offered incredibly clear views of the cosmos in its infancy. What drew astronomers' attention were the tiniest galaxies, covering only a few pixels on Hubble's detector. Most of them do not have the grand spiral or elliptical shapes of large galaxies we see close to us today.
This is Leonard Nottmoy, also known as Mach.
Instead, they are irregular, scrappy collections of stars. The Hubble Deep Field confirmed a long-standing idea that the universe must have evolved in a series of building blocks, with small galaxies gradually merging and assembling into larger ones. You can see evidence of this pattern by looking out into the universe. Many galaxies are gyrating around one another. Some are crashing together, others ripping each other apart. Gravity calls the tune as these galaxies draw together, exchanging stars and gas, and over time, merging to form larger composite galaxies. This came to be known as the hierarchical picture of cosmic history, in which the universe evolved from the ground up, with its structures growing larger and larger over time. A team operating at the Subaru Observatory atop Hawaii's Mauna Kea volcano examined one of the deepest galaxies known, whose light has taken nearly 13 billion years to reach us. It was a messenger from a time not long after the universe was born. This object is known as a quasar, short for quasi-stellar radio source. A small region in its center is so bright that astronomers believe its light is coming not from a collection of stars, but from a single object of at least a billion times the mass of our sun. This beacon is generated by gas falling onto the object and heating up to extreme temperatures. The only thing known to generate this much power is a swirling cauldron where space suddenly turns dark as it merges into a giant black hole. For astronomers, the question was, how did this black hole get so big so early in the history of the universe? It likely got its start in an early generation of stars, often known as Population 3 stars. Made up of hydrogen, they are thought to have been hundreds of times the mass of the Sun. These giant stars burned hot and fast and died young.
At first, I noticed the small things. Bed always made without me asking. His room always cleaned without a fuss. Never had to remind him to do homework. Over time, things got more interesting. And
those ads are so dumb. My microphone's on right now to tell you how dumb these ads are. We're back to Leonard Notmoy, also known as Mock. I can
skip the ad. Skip that ad.
A star is like a cosmic pressure cooker. In its core, the crush of gravity produces such intense heat that atoms are stripped and rearranged. Lighter elements like hydrogen and helium fuse together to form heavier ones like calcium, oxygen, silicon, and finally iron. When enough iron accumulates in the core of the star, it begins to collapse of its own weight. That can send a shockwave racing outward that literally blows the star apart in a supernova. At the moment the star dies, if enough matter falls into its core, it can collapse to a point, forming a black hole. The first generations of stars and black holes burst onto the cosmic scene in a time of incredible turbulence. Within primordial gas clouds, stars were being born in dense knots. They gave rise to black holes that began to swallow more and more matter. A computer simulation of the early universe shows just how quickly these voracious monsters were able to grow. The project, by scientists at Carnegie Mellon University, was designed to recreate a region in the early universe that measured over 100 million light years on a side. It shows what took place in the first 1 billion years of cosmic history. This virtual universe is set in motion by equations describing the properties of gas, the energy released in starbirth, and the outward motion of time and space. The result? An intricate cosmic web, with gravity drawing matter into filaments and knots, like a vast tangle of interconnected spiders' webs. Inside the densest regions is where the largest galaxies and black holes grew. Here, circles indicate the appearance of black holes deep in the data. As they gain weight by eating up their surroundings, the circles grow larger. A few in the largest galaxies reach ultra-massive proportions, billions of times the mass of the Sun. These black holes were not just swallowing gas. The orbiting Chandra X-ray Observatory was dispatched to look into distant galaxies for black holes on growth spurts. Scientists looked for pockets of gas and stars glowing hotly in X-ray light. What Chandra found was that the core of some distant galaxies contained hot pairs, twin supermassive black holes drawn together by gravity. Black holes by nature resist this dark marriage. As the two approach each other, they go into an orbit that could last virtually forever. To learn what allows them to merge, we go back to the ideas developed by Albert Einstein. He said that when massive bodies accelerate or whip around each other, they literally disturb the fabric of space, causing it to ripple like a disturbance on a pond. When these ripples move outward, they carry with them the energy of the pair's orbit, causing them to spiral closer. When this dance of death comes to an end, that's when the pair joins together to form a larger black hole. That moment may be approaching for a quasar called OJ-287 at 3.5 billion light years away. Flare-ups in the surrounding region have led astrophysicists to conclude that another black hole is flying around it. By measuring the giant's gravitational hold on its companion, astronomers estimate its mass at 18 billion solar masses. For a time, OJ-287 was the largest black hole ever detected. It no longer is. Deep in the heart of the Coma Galaxy Cluster, a mere 321 million light years away, lies a giant elliptical galaxy known as NGC 4889. Astronomers used several large telescopes to measure the speed at which stars are orbiting around the center. They used that data to calculate the mass of the central object. A whopping 21 billion solar masses, give or take a few billion. Theoretically, there are no limits to how much weight a black hole can gain. And yet, even the largest black holes and their host galaxies seem to obey limits. What holds them back has to do with the way clusters of galaxies evolve, a pattern long noted by scientists.
I do it to stay sharp. I take care of my body, but it was harder to work out my brain. Well, Lumosity.com is based on neuroscience, and it just seems like games, but it's serious brain training.
Hi, my name is Janine, and this is what I don't remember my lines. What is this picture? Hi, my name's Janine. I don't remember my lines.
This computer simulation shows the evolution of a galaxy cluster in the early universe. the gravity of the entire region draws small galaxies by the thousands, along with great streams of gas into the center. So why doesn't the central galaxy and the black hole that resides within it capture all this matter? Why don't they swallow the entire cluster? You can see the answer in a region called MS0735. At 2.5 billion light years away, it appears in visible light to be a typical galaxy cluster. In X-ray light, you can see that it's enveloped in a cloud of hot gas, measured at nearly 50 million degrees. Hollowed out of this cloud are two immense cavities, up to 600,000 light years across. That's enough room in each to stuff 600 galaxies the size of our Milky Way. Now add in a radio image of the cluster. You can see two vast streams of matter pushing out from the center. That's a giveaway that the cavities were formed by an eruption in the core of the giant central galaxy. Two jets shooting out of a central black hole have launched blast waves that plowed through the gas that makes up the intergalactic medium. The energy it took to carve out these X-ray cavities is remarkable. The equivalent of several billion supernovae, according to one calculation. In fact, MS0735 has been referred to as the largest single eruption recorded since the Big Bang. It was generated by a black hole that weighs in at around 10 billion solar masses. Black hole jets like this have been seen all around the universe, including in our own cosmic neighborhood. This is the famous M87 galaxy, at the center of the Virgo galaxy cluster, around 50 million light years away. Astronomers have been intensively studying the black hole that lurks in its heart, and recently estimated its mass at 6.6 billion solar masses. It powers a pair of high-powered jets that are plowing through the galaxy. But how does a black hole, a creature famous for hiding in the dark, emit this much energy? Think of a black hole as the eye of a cosmic hurricane, kept rotating by all the stars, gas, and other black holes that fall into it. As this matter flows in, it forms a spinning donut-like feature called an accretion disk, which works like a dynamo. The spinning motion of the disk generates magnetic fields that twist around and channel some of the inflowing matter out into a pair of high-energy beams, or jets. How much energy depends on the black hole's gravity and how much matter has already crashed through the event horizon. Is this just another frightening spectacle of nature? Or is it part of a more profound process at work? The largest black holes in the universe probably rose between 10 and 12 billion years ago, the age of the quasars. By releasing energy in the form of jets, they heated up their surrounding regions. This prevented gas from collapsing into the central galaxy and allowed smaller galaxies on the periphery to form and grow. But the impact of the black holes did not stop there. This Chandra image of the Hydra A galaxy cluster shows the same immense hot cavities glowing in X-ray light, as well as a jet blasting out of its central galaxy. Gas along the edge of the jet was found to contain high levels of iron and other metals, probably generated by supernova explosions in the center. By pushing these metals into regions beyond, a black hole seeded more distant galaxies, with the elements needed to form stars in solar systems like ours. The black holes in these more remote galaxies then seeded their own environments. This is what might be happening in Centaurus A, also known as the Hamburger Galaxy. In X-rays, you can see a jet erupting from the center. Peering through the dense dust lanes that dominate our line of sight, astronomers have come to believe that it's actually two galaxies in the act of colliding. This computer simulation shows the effect of such a merger on black holes. As the two galaxies pass by each other, the pull of gravity disrupts their spiral shapes, forcing huge volumes of gas into their cores. As the black holes begin to feed, they emit blast waves that push much of the loose gas out beyond the boundaries of the new galaxy. In the final steps of this cosmic dance, the two black holes merge and emit one final blast. To think that our Earth, our solar system, ourselves, are the beneficiaries of these faraway monsters. The largest black holes have played dual roles in a great cosmic struggle. They are the product of gravity's relentless inward pull, the force that has drawn matter into galaxies, clusters, and the structures they form. But with their incredible power, they emit energy that pushes back on gravity. In so doing, these strange and powerful objects have become the master architects of space and time.
We're back! That was a long video, eh?
Fucking Janine. Janine from Luminosity. She should use that product. She should use the Luminosity program. She couldn't remember her lines. I watched that commercial. Mm-hmm. And that girl could not for the life of her remember what to say.
Not a very good spokesperson for
Janine,
the cause, obviously.
Janine, you should use Luminosity.
Somebody hasn't been checking their app daily.
That crazy... Yeah, her apps are calamari.
I love that calamari app.
Me too.
They spell it with a K, though.
Calamari. Some cheese sticks. All right. So let's... Uh, Let's go with a little bit of comedy for atheists. Actually, no. Yeah, let's go with some comedy. Nah. Let's just take it right off and go with the secret trinity of Freemasons.
Ah.
Well, they mentioned that the black holes are the great architects or the grand architects of the universe. And coincidentally, the god in which I serve, I refer to as the grand architect. And coincidentally, so do some other people.
I'd say that's not a coincidence.
No, that's not a coincidence.
Since they're all related.
Sure.
And in fact,
cousins, sisters, brothers.
The ideas that you
foster families
subscribe to, Al, relate a lot to King Solomon, you would say, right?
Oh, I think they definitely go back to Solomon.
And of course, the Freemasons themselves.
The key of Solomon.
Base sort of the foundation of their ideas around Solomon. The whole tale is about the building of a.
Three main cultures, or three main entities, they base their beliefs around, stemming from three cultures, and people have a misconception that this deity that, or it's not even a deity, it's this amalgamation of the word for God from three cultures, and that's kind of what this video is about.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right, let's play it.
Was that photogenic?
Oh, yes, I think so.
So you're back, but a strange thing that it's not outputting the sound in live stream now.
So interesting.
We might have to actually restart this program because it looks like this channel
hijinks
is dead.
Hijinks and trickery.
But let me
perhaps,
try one more time here.
Perhaps we should just not even show this truth.
You
know what? We're keeping this truth. Forget it. Ow. Search it out yourself.
It won't matter if it's this video or any other video. It's live stream this time.
Really?
Yeah. It's actually in Procaster, in the producer program.
It's something that's been glitched from the glitchers.
Because I'm listening to the audio of the sound on my headphones, but... So the video itself isn't broken.
Hmm.
Yeah, but hold on, let me try one more time. Let's try with a different video here.
Let's try a different one.
Uh-huh. No, it's toast. That channel's toast.
Really?
Yeah.
All right, we're going to restart the...
I'm adding a new source.
Sourcing. We got it sourced.
Oh, we got you back. And
we're
we gave
back.
You a cool. We tested it with an awesome echo.
We're back with echoes.
That's right. Okay, so this should work now.
No, I'm not so sure if we should play it.
Oh. You think the Freemasons were telling you something?
No, I just think that, you know what? No, we're going to keep this. If you want to search this truth out, you can just search it out yourself.
Interesting.
I changed my mind.
Like your spontaneity.
Changed my mind just like that.
Now everybody's gonna be like, "Damn,
we're gonna play
that,
it,
man."
No, we're not. No, hey, let's play that Leonard Nimoy video again.
Leonard Nimoy. It wasn't him.
No, it totally wasn't. But at fucking 5 a.m. I really thought it was him because I'm still really stoned and half asleep. I did mushrooms before bed again, too, so.
Well, that'll do it.
When I woke up, I was kind of high. I ate a little too much before I went to bed. And I got up at just after 4 a.m. Fuck, I keep doing this, man. What am I doing? All right, let's go with comedy for atheists.
Did you copy that link?
Creationism. Who we got here? Green Supreme says no sound, and I think we figured that out.
Oh, that was probably from...
Yeah. Well, before. It takes a while. This phone is
That's
locked.
Right. Yeah, no, your sound should be fine now. I'm monitoring you, and you sound fine, so.
Cool. We got comedy for atheists?
We do. Let's play this one.
Let's do it.
All right.
It's a funny little
cartoon.
It's a funny little cartoon. Son's name is Jeffrey. Who would have thought? Oh, yeah. Here's something else. According to a misleading study, that pot smokers under the age of 30 have a sperm with low self-esteem? A high percentage of sperm with low self-esteem. So go buy your sperm a new pair of shoes. Take it to the spa. You know? The hell.
All right, here's the video.
There should already be water here somewhere, but I can't see shit. Let there be light. Okay, that's better. Let there be an expanse to separate water from water, and I'll call that sky. Sweet. Let dry ground appear.
Not bad at all.
Let the land produce vegetation. Let there be lights in the expanse to separate day and night. I'll call them the sun and the moon and the stars.
Whoa, back up. You created the sun and the moon and the stars after you created light? And you created plants before you created the sun?
Yeah, so?
Nothing. Forget it.
Moving on. Let us create the fish of the sea and the animals of the land of all their different kinds.
But wait a minute. You created this endless universe with millions of galaxies and with billions upon billions of stars in each galaxy, with countless planets and trillions of different life forms on Earth, and you did this all just for man? I mean, that seems a little wasteful, doesn't it?
Shut the hell up, Jeffrey.
God, I really don't get this.
It's not that hard to figure out. Round peg, round hole. Catch up, Jeffrey.
Yeah, but why would they even want to do this?
To make more people, of course. I don't want to have to create everybody. Also, it'll feel really, really good.
That's a good idea. If you want them to love you, well, you should make them happy. Good idea, God.
Yeah, I know. I thought of it. I'm gonna call it sex. Oh, they're really gonna love me down there, Jeffrey. They're even gonna scream out my name when they do it.
Yeah, well, that's why you're making them, isn't it? You're making them to, love you.
Well, yeah, but it sounds kind of sad and pathetic when you say it like that. Well, okay, it's been a hard few days, but I got the universe created. Now all I gotta do is create man.
So, God, how are you gonna make this dude anyway?
Simple. I'll use a handful of dirt. Hang on. See, there he is. I made him in my image.
Your image? Yeah, right. I think you're a little bit too generous downstairs, if you know what I mean.
Jeffrey, shut the hell up.
Okay, God, it's been a long few days, but you made the universe, and you made Earth, and the sun, and the moon, and the land, and the water, and the plants, and animals, and man. I guess all you got left now is to make a woman, right?
Not so fast, Jeffrey. First, I want to, put a tree of knowledge down there in the Garden of Eden.
Tree of knowledge, huh? What's that do?
Oh, it'll fuck everything up royally. Big time.
Well, why would you put that there? I thought you wanted these people to love you.
Yeah, but it'll be funny to watch them fuck up, won't it?
I don't know. I don't get this, God. You go through all this trouble to make this perfect being, and then you put this tree down there that's gonna fuck him up? What's the point? I mean, I just don't get this.
Oh, you'll be thanking me later when you're laughing your ass off. Adam, listen up. I'm about to bring you a helper, but first, I wanted to talk to you about something. You see that tree over there with the really delicious-looking fruit? That is the tree of knowledge.
Get it back up. Strange. Freeze. Don't know why YouTube's freezing. Oh, now it came back. Okay, now it's ready.
YouTube is just being... Do we go back to me yet, or...
Yeah, yeah. Well, we can just... We're already on you now. We're going back to the YouTube video here.
YouTube.
YouTube. All right, here we go.
It's all fucking up.
The fruit from that tree, I swear by me, you'll die. You will surely die. You hear me talking to you, boy?
So, God, what are you going to make a woman with? Another handful of dirt?
Nah, I'll yank out one of Adam's ribs.
Ouch, that's going to hurt. Why the hell would you do that?
Relax, Jeffrey. I'll wait till he's sleeping.
Oh, she's fine. God, Adam is gonna like you.
Yeah, I know. Remember what I said. Now have fun.
Adam, try a piece of that fruit. Please? Pretty please?
Do not. Okay. My work is done here. Think I'll take the day off.
Let me put it this way. If you don't eat a piece of that, then you don't get a piece of this.
God, you said round peg, round hole, right?
Yeah, why?
Well, I guess you shouldn't have gave her those other holes then, because they're doing it wrong.
Shit.
Those nutty atheists. What other things do you think atheists would think was funny? Synagogues? Churches?
Probably all of the above.
Yeah. I wonder if that's like a comedy club for atheists. Let's go to a Buddhist temple today. Comedy club for atheists. We're going to the Buddhist temple today, get a little chuckle. Tomorrow we're going to go to a Ukrainian Orthodox. Yeah. Those crazy atheists. All right. We're going to play a little video, little home video. I take home videos every now and then. I like to push them on you people. This one is of somebody's private collection of... really potent scissor hash. So I guess it's technically a fresh and local produce. And it kind of, you know, it's kind of self-explanatory as to why I don't trim my weed. But I'm happy other people do. Because if nobody did, I wouldn't be able to enjoy private collections like that. All right. How we doing over there, Jer?
Good. I'm just getting the scissor hash video up here.
Jared's just making the scissor hash right now.
That's
right. We gotta film that, and then we'll have that up in a second.
So this was 10, was it?
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. We're gonna go open.
Oops. It's number 10. Number 10 on the CamVids misrepresented list. They showed up backwards today. I don't understand what happens with that thing.
This thing is fucked. Okay, so this is this one. Oh, very nice. Okay.
Yeah, that's the one.
That's the one. All right, I'm going to try to make it full screen. We should be good to go.
We're going full screen.
Baby, full screen it.
Fuck yeah.
Ooh, but if it's full screen, it's got all that stuff on the bottom. I'm going to actually tailor it so they don't have to look at the...
Tailor-made full screen.
We don't want them to see all the...
Slightly trimmed. I don't know why I'm doing this. It kind of makes it more... It's full screen. It's that weed juice. It's got me quite chipper. I feel like going for a jog.
Okay, that should do the trick, I think. One more.
A little more trim?
There we go.
Jeremiah the barber by the lake.
That's right. All right, we're ready to roll here.
All right.
Okay. Scissor hash, yum.
And this video...
What's going on, guys? We're looking at a bunch of hash. This is all scissor hash from a friend's collection who was gracious enough to put it here on loaner for this video. Really nice. This is Master Kush. Most of these are just miscellaneous garden mixes. Couple grams of this, couple grams of that, you know. But all in all, a really nice collection. This is some Harmony right here. Also known as Rockstar. This is Congolese. Also known as the Congo. Also known as Wicked Fucking Weed. This one here is a miscellaneous garden mix. Let me put this up here. There you go. Hi. Miscellaneous mix. This one actually is pretty melty, considering all the plant matter in here. And that's the thing about scissor hash. This is why I don't really trim my weed, because it ends up on the scissors. Now I'm happy that other people trim their weed, because then I get to enjoy people's private collections like this from time to time. So I really give thanks and respect for those people that are diligent enough to collect this stuff. Fucking A. Alright. Let's see here. Melts. A little bit melty. Got some T-Rex going on here. This one's a little meltier. So, what we're gonna do is we're gonna do some rips. So give me 1 minute. Close this stuff up. Don't want to spill any of this stuff. It's so precious and rare. All right.
Let's start with some harmony. So nice. Sublimator. I really think it's the tastiest rip on the market. Doesn't matter if you're using weed, hash, rub, butter, honey oil, doesn't matter. Really delivers a flavorful rip. Wow, is that good? Broke the sweat on that one. All right. Life's a gas. Congolese. What a beautiful gift. That's a lungful. As serious as life gets, it is a gas.
You're back?
Yep.
Yep. All right. Hooked on a feeling. So hooked on a feeling. What else do we got? Oh, fuck, let's play...
Your love balloon?
We could play the love balloon. It's just a short little video. It's got bad sound, but...
We don't even need to play the sound. We can go to you. You can talk over top of it.
All right, here
we
go.
Here's the love balloon. Look at it.
All right, this is a pretty lady I saw on the stairs that I was running. I put on a rain suit when it's hot out, and I run the stairs. And this is a pretty lady that was holding a giant white orb that said love. Turns out they were doing an art project. What they were doing was filming it in different locations around Vancouver. And basically they went up a few flights of stairs and threw it down the stairs and filmed this giant love orb as it was going towards them.
That's
so, yeah.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, a little art project. I thought it was kind of neat.
Love orb.
Love orbs. Those love orbs. Love crazy orbs. Atheists and their love orbs. Hey,
so
you know
what's
we
next,
could...
Al?
Fuck, let's play the encore from the Sharon Jones and the Dap Kings show. This is one of the funnest encores I've...
This is on your cam?
Yeah, this is on the cam. It's 0635.
Gotcha.
Yeah, this was a really fun encore. I figured I'd play it. We got a Sharon video, too, we could play after.
It's not hooked on a feeling?
No, it's not hooked on a feeling. But I think we're going to close out with hooked on a feeling again.
Oh, yeah, that's a good plan. Very good plan. Okay, yeah, this is ready to go anytime.
0635?
Yeah, it's ready to go. Yeah. All right, let's do it. Man.
stage. That means I need you right here on stage. I need you right here on stage. I need you, you.
Now our sound is good too.
We're all good.
We're all good. You know, shit happens sometimes.
It does.
You know, it's how we do it.
Yep, and I'm monitoring everything. Looks like we're all good again.
That's how we
adapt.
It was
the freeze. It was the live stream freeze.
You know, the more shit that happens, the more we can learn and evolve. What do you think?
I agree with you.
All right.
The more shit that happens, the more you learn and evolve. Guaranteed.
Like a few months ago, stabbings all over the place.
Brian's got a question. Stabbings. Well,
what's the deal?
Shootings, I think, it's just turf shit.
There's lots of shootings going. No, well, not, it's not all turf shit because there's
old
these,
vendettas, turf shit.
Well, but some of the ones lately have been, for instance, the school shootings. There's been a couple crazy ones.
No, now, are you referring to in Vancouver or?
Well, there's the Moncton shooting. So there's the Moncton shooting where the guy shot three cops, and he was on the run for days or a day. And then there was also this crazy shooting in Seattle where a guy unloaded in school, I think. He unloaded in school on some peeps and he killed two people.
What kind of gun was he using?
And then there was this other guy who went into
on.
A school.
No, the school shooting is very important because generally in school shootings, there guns are used that are about to be. How could I say they get slated like they're deadly guns. Right?
Oh yeah. I don't think that was the case in these ones. There was a bunch of different. Those were three different things. The Moncton guy had several guns on him. I think he was using a rifle or something.
Oh yeah, yeah, I know that. But I'm talking about the school shootings.
The school shootings. I think I'm not sure about the Seattle guy, but I read about the other one where the guy was all pissed off that he didn't have a girlfriend, and he put a YouTube video up his manifesto that he was mad at all the girls.
Oh yeah, you got to forget all about that. It's all about what kind of gun was he using.
The one that he was using was a completely legal gun. He said he did research on it. He actually wrote about why he chose that gun. He said it was, one of the most accurate weapons, that kind of stuff.
Now let's watch over the next 3 months.
Yeah.
The sale of those weapons, those specific
guns.
Go
up hugely.
Yeah.
Yeah, the sale goes up by mad amounts.
And what was happening, what was happening right around the time with legislation on gun control?
Oh yeah, for sure. They're trying to control guns in the
United States. So a lot of what we see are,
well, some of it could be false flag type operations.
I believe that. Yeah, I think a lot of it's false flag. A lot of it is
with this kid who was doing his whole thing. I doubt that was false flag because there's so much evidence showing that this kid was just a crazy motherfucker.
Well,
and they have he wrote it all down. He recorded on video. He recorded a video and uploaded it from his car right as it was happening and shit. He ran a bunch of people down with his car and shit. So this guy was a crazy motherfucker. But I mean, there's these school shootings are happening all over.
I just think a lot of times there's some sort of link.
Well, check this out.
If we look in the person's history, maybe
they want to control guns in the U.S. big time.
Well,
actually, the audience is following. I think what you're saying is that if there's a shooting, there's going to be an easier reaction amongst gun owners who say, "Oh shit, the gun laws are going to tighten up. Better buy."
And a lot of times, the weapon that is used becomes restricted shortly thereafter.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So for all we know, I've never really, really looked into it, but who's to say that that weapon wasn't slated for restriction 6 months before? Manufacturers are like, "Hey, we got to fucking
we got to
increase sales here, because in 2 months this thing's not like a third of the people that can purchase this, third of the people will be able to purchase this out of the whole total amount."
In some cases, these things seem to happen directly when particular legislation is being pushed.
Around legislation and also around elections, depending on who stands for what during which election, we see these events happen a lot.
That's true.
I hate to bring on
It's all true. And now here's
conspiracy
the other thing,
point of view. I'm a real big fan of conspiracy because you can turn anything into a conspiracy.
Yeah.
Anything at all, if you're creative enough, you can say, well, there's a conspiracy to do this or that within this organization.
But there is a lot of evidence in some of these particular cases of false flag operations. I'm not saying that it's necessarily my go look at places like InfoWars if you want to get idea of that stuff.
To convey the things that I learn as facts that back up these certain theories. You know, like weather control. Well, we already know Ben Livingston did it. Then we already know that the Weather Modification Incorporated, they exist out of Fargo or Grand Forks, somewhere in North Dakota. So we know these things are factual. I'd have to really look in to see, I don't know how you would prove this is factual.
Here's the thing that's interesting to me.
I guarantee the angles point towards this is definitely something that is controlled.
You know, the shooting that happened
Canada,
at the...
I think in Canada, it's again to fuck with the long gun registry.
Oh, yeah.
Because he used a rifle. He used a long gun.
Right.
Long gun registry.
That's
boom,
a weird
bring
thing.
It. Enron pipeline's coming, fucking, or Enbridge pipeline's coming. We gotta fucking can long guns because all these guys that live in the bush have long guns. We need to know where all of them are again. Re-register your long guns.
Yeah, that stuff's all
guns.
Stupid.
But now,
next 3 years, we're gonna.
But
see
like, it. For example, the shooting that happened, you know, the one with the runners where it was outside. It was at the marathon event, and there was a bomb that went off or whatever.
Oh, that's the Boston Marathon.
Boston Marathon.
Well, that's that. We know that that was it was a real thing that happened.
Yeah.
Some people got hurt. Some people staged their
right.
hurt. Some people got paid to undergo crazy surgeries, like astronomical amounts,
but,
and then got huge, huge...
And they had all those weird Blackwater soldiers hanging around with those... They were all wearing the same uniforms, caps, backpacks, boots.
I did a show on that. There's definitely a very interesting picture. It's a communications van... Right, it's this crazy black ops van with dishes on top. Around it are all of these dudes that are supposed to be civilians. They're all in the same beige pants and black jacket. They all kind of look the same, and they're all in a circle. There's mayhem going on everywhere. A couple guys are talking into their shirts. And in the forefront, to the left... Now, this is a staged photograph without a doubt, without a doubt, without a doubt. There's two wheelchairs facing opposite of each other. Okay? One has a Red Cross flag, right? And you would expect the Red Cross to be present, but the other one has a Swiss flag. Hmm. And they're parting ways.
Oh, so they've...
I just think it's a
photo manipulation.
No, I don't. It's not a photo manipulation. This was definitely a photo that was taken. I just think it's a it was a staged photograph at the event as a private communication that states something symbolically. That's what I say. And Switzerland is moving towards the left, I believe, in this photograph. Now, we know that the direction of left and right in politics are very, you know. Yeah, they mean a lot if you're on the left side or the right side. So, what do we got left? Oh, fuck, we don't have a whole lot of time left. Let's play more Hasselhoff. Let's play the ripoff. This is some really, really clever fucking editing. Like, so clever, it borders on brilliance. Wow. That's the OG wreck I just took a hit of. Holy fuck. Strong shit. We're ready?
Yep.
The ripoff.
Now, this is a story all about how my life got flipped, turned upside down. Now I can take a minute, just sit right there. I tell you how I became the prince of a town called Bel Air.
What happened in here?
We was robbed!
You're absolutely right. In West Philadelphia,
born and raised on the playground is where I spend most of my days. Chilling out, maxing, relaxing, and all shooting some b-ball outside of your school. When a couple of guys who were up to no good started making trouble in my neighborhood, I got in one little fight. My mom got scared and said, "You're moving with your auntie and uncle." In LA, a whistle broke out, and when he came near the license plate, said, "Fresh and out of dice in the mirror." If anything could say that this cat was rare, I thought, "Nah." Forget it. You homes to Bel Air. I pulled up to a house about 7 or 8, and I yelled to the cabbie, "You homes, smell you later." Looked at my kingdom. I was finally there to sit on my throne as the prince of Bel. Thank you.
Fucking Hasselhoff, he does it all. He acts, he directs, he sings, he raps.
Pretty good rapper, too.
I pulled up to the house. Fuck, that was awesome. Great editing. Hasselhuffer. You're an atheist, I know you are. I don't know what else to play. We've got more black hole stuff, but I'm having too much fun with other shit. And we're almost out of time anyways.
We are. We've got 10 minutes.
Let's play that short NASA video. NASA neutron stars rip each other apart. This is a nice little theoretical digital animation thing with some great sound. It's got some beautiful music going on. Well, no. It's just all right.
Hey, there's something going on. What's going on?
I don't know. We're getting some feedback.
We got feedback?
Yeah, I'm not sure what, but give me a sec. We should give you the echo treatment. I just gave you a nice
echo treatment.
Just for a second, there was an.
Oh wait, this isn't the one.
No, that's not the one.
Okay.
I'm trying to find. Sorry, which one was it?
NASA and neutron stars rip each other apart.
We haven't played it yet because we had a sound issue there for a second.
All right.
That's ready to go.
All right, let's do it.
Let's do it.
Let's do this like Buddhists, like we never knew this. All right, we're back. That was some NASA simulation videos.
Yeah.
There's a whole bunch of them. If you go to NASA Goddard, there's a whole bunch of crazy videos.
There's a link at the end of this. Hold on a second. We just missed it because I went back a little before.
And I'm noticing that links to the Goddard Space Flight Center.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm noticing the Goddards are a very astute family. As I'm looking into this Goddard thing. Goddard. Yeah. There we go. The Goddard Flight Center. All right. We're going to get going. We're almost out of time. I've got some very wispy, long flower here. You guys know how I hate using sativa as a term. It's all sativa. All this weed has been cultivated, so it's all sativa. All right. We're going to peace out. Thanks for tuning in to Class in Session. Drop me an email, classinsession666@gmail.com. Hey, what's this? Apparently, I've got a Twitter thing. What's going on with Twitter?
Alchemist. A-L_DA.
Here, wait. Hey, hang on. Sorry. Here, you...
Just tell it's off.
Follow Al at... go to hashtag class in session. That's the quickest way to connect with Al's Twitter account. But it's at Al_DA_alchemist.
So. There you go. I didn't know that. But it just happened as we were sitting here, really. So apparently UFC is in town this weekend. Joe Rogan's in town. You're invited down to Cannabis Culture. Come on out to Pot TV. Rumor mill has it there's going to be some exquisite sativas for you to inhale if you do so wish. I personally won't be in town. I'm going to be doing some sublimator business at the Vapes on Main in Winnipeg. And their brand new location, not like Vapes on Main isn't new, but they've already got a second location. It's Canna Claws by Vapes on Main, and that's on Corridon Avenue. So yeah, we're going to be in Winnipeg doing some stuff, maybe even Saskatoon and Edmonton as well. We'll see if time permits. So thanks for tuning in. Class in Session at 666@gmail.com. Thanks to B-Real and B-Real TV and everybody over there. I heard rumors that you're coming up to Canada with Exhibit. I don't know if that's just rumor mill shit, but it's coming out of Winnipeg anyways. Yeah. So if that's the case, I'll fly out and meet you there. And if that's not the case, then whatever.
You want to play a song, Al, for the end of the show?
Yeah, we're going to play a song. Let's play Mortar. This is the Grand Architect by, I think it's a UK-based hip-hop crew known as Mortar. They're brand new to me. I just stumbled upon them, but I dig what they're saying. So, fuck yeah, peace out. Keep the dirty side down and have fun. This is 307 West Hastings, Cannabis Culture Headquarters. Come to the Vapor Lounge. Mark Emery's going to be out by the end of August. We expect he'll be in the fucking building. Hopefully right here on the show beside me. Yeah. Because he's the Prince of Pot. This is Class in Session, so when he's in the building, he's the Principal of Pot as well. Mm-hmm. The Dean.
There you go.
The Dean of Green. Yeah?
The Dean of Green, I like
the
that
The Dean
one.
Of Green, Mark Emery.
Dean of Green.
Yep. All right,
Vance Dam University.
307 West Hastings. Come buy a bong. Come upstairs, smoke it. Vapor Lounge rocks. Check out Jeremiah's show on Fridays. Check out From Under the Influence with Marijuana Man on Wednesdays. Marius Stoner on Fridays. Jody.
Thursday, Fridays.
She does her show in private, so it's not live, but it gets usually posted the same day or the day after. So Thursday night or Friday, look for her show. And Redbeard show.
Oh yeah, don't forget.
Fuck,
Redbeard
there's a lot of
Saturday.
Shows going on now.
That's right.
Kush
4 p.m.
Cup is
Saturday.
just starting. They're looking at Cheech and Chong with War.
Yeah.
So if you can help, Mark out, how do they find Mark?
Oh, you can find Mark at Mega Ill Pizza,
I Medicate Dispensary
in
Vancouver. Yeah.
Or just go on Facebook and type in Mark Clokeed, the weed guy. You'll find him.
There you go. Yeah. If you want to make a donation or anything, you got any ideas or hookups for other entertainment, hit him up. And we're out. Thanks for watching. And this is the Grand Architect. Peace out, motherfuckers.
The Most High Exalted, I'm I'm literally spitting various complex concepts. Death charge and blast with military bomb threats. Switching my mission, foregone conclusion. Unshackled the strains, no collaborating or collusion. Proving my worth, maneuver for first place. You're mistaken if you ain't figure that this is a race. I take aim and flame, the starter's gun's gone. I practice track tactics while you faggots plunder on. Swan song victory, simply put. The prophet of rocking it as often as you never could. Look, truly, do you see mortar? Wings of the seraphim, golden aura, teleporter of disorder. Leviathan on the mic, rise from the waters. Venom sender, right and strike with the tide of force for total destruction. Crush your opinions, power over your virtues like the hash million dominions. Lord of form, lord of wisdom, lord of flame, nameless in the ways and precision of my vision. Divine intuition, listen when it's spoken. Give a service from the mount, murder your firstborn when it's over. So king of kings, master among masters, the most high exalted, it's more than matter. I speak the truth, unshackle your mind light. See it for the first time, you're blinded by the light that I write. King of kings, master among masters, the most high exalted, it's more than matter. I speak the truth, unshackle your mind light. See it for the first time, you're blinded by the light that I write. Born a flame into the eye of the hurricane, I fly, defy death, left to reside on a higher plane. Radiating light, the white Vader, the Bible, the Quran, the Book of Law, and the Hindu papers combined in my mind, unleashed. Calling the fallen morning star with the mark of the beast. Preach no defeat from the temple. Speak at high degrees like a sovereign grand inspector general. Thanks for the venom, all praise the nameless. The knowledge of the past is vast and can't be contained in one simple truth, transmuted as one belief and venerated as one faith that remains unseen. The dream catcher, weaver and dispatcher, left behind if you believe in the rapture. Rewind and backtrack to the beginning. My lyrics lying outside the explanations of science, nature or creationism. The king of kings, master among masters, the most high exalted, it's more than matter. I speak the truth, unshackle your mind light. See it for the first time, you're blinded by the light that I write. King of kings, master among masters, the most high exalted, it's more than matter. I speak the truth, unshackle your mind light. See it for the first time, you're blinded by the light that I write. I am the written law, every word recorded, transported to foreign shores and duly reported. Primordial waters, we're swimming in, the villain winning, agenda reptilian, blood swilling, a million winged avengers sent for demon spawn, seeking repentance. The head of the venomous one's tongue torn from, challenge to battle at dawn, the sun of the morning. The rain pouring, acid when we clash, Poseidon's trident strikes lightning when Thor's hammer smash. You write in shatters like clay tablets, ran the risk of violence, publishing pacifist manifest. This faction traveled back and carry forth the covenant and deposit it in Axum. The last dragon, reign never over, the epic of Gilgamesh left fresh in the mind of Homer. King of kings, master among masters, the most high exalted, it's more than matter. I speak the truth, unshackle your mind light, see it for the first time.